Hello, good evening. This is the Václav Havel Library and I'm Michael Zantowski, and it is my great pleasure and honor to welcome in Prague our special guest, Rosa Maria Payá, and one of the usual suspects, Martin Palouš. And I think it's very proper and fitting that this evening takes place in the Václav Havel Library, because as many of you know, Václav Havel took a keen interest in Cuba, in the human rights situation in Cuba, in the democratic opposition in Cuba, and he was a supporter of the Cuban cause for many, many years. And in particular, he was a great admirer and later friend of a great Cuban human rights defender, Oswaldo Payá, a very courageous man, a man of tolerance and peace, a man who believed very much in the same values that Václav Havel believed in, and who was also Rosa's father. And unfortunately, as you also may have heard, he died 3 years ago in 2012 under very suspicious circumstances, and it was a tragedy for the human rights cause in Cuba, and of course it was a tragedy for his family. Fortunately, Václav Havel had an opportunity to meet Oswaldo Payá in person when he came to Prague in 2003, and after he received the Sakharov Prize for human rights, and they exchanged letters later on in the library. We have three pairs of letters and replies to letters between the two men, and you will hear more about that later on from Martin. And I was also very fortunate to have met Oswaldo in Cuba, in his home country, in 1999, when I brought him the first human rights awards to be presented to a Cuban dissident on the territory of Cuba, the Homo Homini Award, given by the People in Need organization, another group very friendly to the late president and to this library. And one of the ways in which we tried, and the People in Need tried, to support the cause of democracy in Cuba was a work by Václav Havel, his probably most famous essay, The Power of the Powerless, or in Spanish, El Poder de los Sin Poder. And I think the title in Spanish is even more poetic than it is in English. So this is an evening in remembrance of a great man, but not just remembrance, because Rosa Maria is a human rights activist in her own right, and you will hear about her activities throughout the evening. I will briefly introduce Martin, because he does not need much introduction. Martin is one of my predecessors in this post of the director of the Václav Havel Library. He's also one of my successors as ambassador to Washington, and he went on to become the permanent representative of the Czech Republic to the United Nations. He's the president of the Václav Havel Library Foundation in New York, and he's also the director of the Center for Human Rights and Diplomacy at the Florida International and university where I had the pleasure to visit him last week. So this is all from me, and now it's on to you, Martin and Rosa.
Sure. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming for this, I think, quite interesting opportunity for interaction exchange with someone who I think has something similar on my own in her heart, what actually we used to have here in the past and still is strongly on our agenda. Actually, we've just come from Berlin with Rosa, where we experienced beautiful things. There was a conference, Quo Vadis Cuba, organized by Konrad Adenauer Stiftung with on our initiation, and there were so many other communications about Cuba. My basic point is, and I'm certainly going to challenge Rosa on this one, is that Cuba is not only important for Cubans. That if we all others think how to express our solidarity with Cubans, it's not that we are doing something for them, but maybe we are also doing something for ourselves, just to think again about essential questions and maybe to understand better the current circumstances under which we are living. I suggest to divide these conversations and try to limit myself as much as possible and to give space to Rosa to three sections. Michael Notowski meant the communications, so this referred to communications between Oswaldo Payá and Václav Havel. I have here in front of me first two letters that were written in 2003, which means now times were running quickly a long time ago. But it seems to me that what Oswaldo and Václav were saying here is still quite important and relevant for us. So I will, in the first part, you will hear from me and I will read that. And then I will give floor to Rosa. Three things. First of all, Václav Havel, Oswaldo Payá, their communication. Then, second question would be, Rosa was one of these young persons, obviously, she has always started as a kid, living in a dissident family. Perceiving this situation from her own perspective and bearing consequences from the decisions made by her father, by others, and then taking their own choices and doing her own things. And then third and most importantly, what we are trying to do here is to send you a strong message what's going on today. What's going on today with Cuba in after the Obama's decision, President Obama decided to start engaging Cuban government in a kind of rapprochement. The European Union has the same intentions, and some people believe that Cuba is a tremendous opportunity, not only just to lie on beaches and enjoy whatever you can enjoy in this under these circumstances, but maybe businessmen believe that now they need to go there. Americans are already coming, so we must be there first and to maybe make our Cuban partners happy and make some profit on it. That will be up to Rosa to tell us what the Cuban Democratic Opposition is doing. Rosa now she's now going to speak not only for herself, but she's a member of Coordination Committee, Commission of Cuban Democratic Opposition, that tries now really to speak in one voice and send a serious message to be considered by politicians. We actually had a good experience this afternoon. The Speaker of the Czech Parliament, or President of the Czech Parliament, Mr. Hamáček, received Rosa, and we got quite interesting words of encouragement and promises from him. So that's the third point. But let me to start from Oswaldo and Václav, what they were saying 2003. From Oswaldo Payá to Václav Havel, dear friend, and I'm just going through it, I don't want to read it all, but we always thought that the European peoples who had been subjected to communism, including the Russians, would understand our situation and once liberated, would start movements of solidarity with Cuba. Sadly, however, many East Europeans seem to have suffered memorials or to have plunged so rapidly into the freedom of the market that they have no time for their outcast Cuban brothers and sisters who share a plight that was once the East Europeans' own. That it is why I value Czechs, Slovaks, Hungarians, Poles, and others with sound memories and generous hearts who have extended their solidarity to us over the years. A few paragraphs later, let us go back to the subject of transition. In the Latin American context, this term can be interpreted as the path toward models that have achieved nothing for some peoples, resulting only in an increase of poverty for the majority, corruption, and nagging doubts about the legitimacy of formal democracy. That is not our goal. The Cuban regime's propaganda and its systematic disinformation have adjusted themselves since the fall of the myth of the invincible Soviet Empire. The aim now is to scare the Cuban people. This has been done with some efficiency. The population has been frightened with an image of the chaos and misery that have supposedly resulted from the transitions in Eastern European countries once dominated by communism. And a little bit more. I will start here. The fraud lies in presenting the destructive and abhorrent fruit of communism and its consequences as evils of the nascent democracies. Look at what freedom has done to you. It would have been better to have remained as you once were. Here, if I may return to the topic of Cuba, is a ready-made priority for most Cubans have never money, property, resources, or training. We have nothing. The business people of the future can only be the rich individuals of the present. Only they have or can have anything now. Under the so-called market economy, they would remain in charge and the majority would remain powerless. By this I mean to say what change in Cuba cannot be a prolongation of the disadvantages of the majority, because a new society cannot be built on the basis of these disadvantages. In a totalitarian state, the majority of the population is totally disadvantaged. So although we don't reject the concept of transition, we remember that the process which Cubans have initiated as one of liberation. In this, we are radical. We are radically peaceful because we don't accept violence as a means of achieving change. Because we are motivated not by hate, but rather by love for our Cuban brothers. The phase of Cuban history now coming to an end has been very complex in human terms. And another of the bitter fruits of this regime would be to continue pitting Cubans against one another over what has happened up to now. We would thus continue submitting ourselves to the hate and injustice the totalitarianism has sown. Forgiveness and reconciliation are vital in this process of liberation, and that's why peaceful struggle is not only our method, but our aim. We want to put violence, hatred, and insults behind us for all. We believe this is possible because most Cubans harbor the same feelings that we have. Even those who are part of the power structure are trapped by a system that doesn't respect their own rights, although it grants them privileges. I keep thinking today about today's Czech Republic. You have achieved change and liberation. You have done it, and most importantly, done it on your own terms. We will achieve this in Cuba. We are already doing it among Cubans, among everyone, those of us who live on the inside, and those who live in exile, and are an inseparable part of our nation. The Valera Project is already a citizens' movement for peaceful change. It goes forward thanks to the courage of those who take the steps of personal liberation and overcome fear. But it is also a step towards solidarity with their own people, since they demand respect for the rights of all. Therein lies the fundamental change that we seek. The participation of citizens in the political, economic and cultural life of the country as free people. And the very end of the letter of Oswaldo. I know that you understand very well the types of danger and hope through which we Cubans are now living. The Cuban people are in need of solidarity. Solidarity with the civic campaign for peaceful change that has expressed itself in the Valera Project and that continues to spread in the midst of repression, which is no longer able to paralyze us. My dear friend Václav, I would like to translate to the Czech people our greetings of solidarity and our gratitude to all those who support our peaceful fight with their voices and their work. Thank you for the support you have given to me by nominating me for the Nobel Peace Prize. Many Cubans welcomed it as a show of support for the cause of Cuba's freedom, which is also the cause of peace. And now, Václav to Oswaldo. Dear friend, these days, even I'm wondering through machine time, Oswaldo is talking about machine time in his letter too, as you put it in your letter. But I have the indisputable advantage of doing so only in my memory and in my thoughts. Your letter actually arrived just before the anniversary of November 17, the day on which Czechs and Slovaks commemorate the beginning of the overthrow of the communist totalitarian regime. This occasion always inspired me to a deeper reflection on the experience of these days and a contemplation of what turned out well and what did it not. The end of the totalitarian regime era in the former Czechoslovakia was marked by the extreme nervousness of the part of the regime. Those who had long thought they would hold their posts in perpetuity began to lose their footing. Some of them probably had already started to sense that they would have to plan, if not for political survival, then at least for responding to societal change. The handful of previously scorned dissidents started to be taken seriously when a group number of citizens began publicly displaying sympathy towards them. Even the totalitarian regime had already stopped pretending that these dissidents were merely a few fanatics supported by foreign intelligence. And in the 2 years before its collapse, the regime had to intervene with brute force against a growing number of citizens during demonstrations linked to the anniversaries of the significant political events. The citizens of Czechoslovakia saw in the streets for the first time in 20 years armed police cars together with emergency squads armed to the teeth. And I go quickly forward, and this will be, I will read it through, but that's the end that you will hear from Rosa. Based on my experience, international solidarity is important at this time. Such solidarity should be expressed by free governments as well as by individuals. Democratic countries should make their relations with their totalitarian political leadership conditional on the release of prisoners of conscience and on the relaxation of inhibition of free nationwide discussion. Democratic countries should consider as their partners all democratically minded people, irrespective of whether or not they hold any political offices. In this context, I expect a lot from the founding of the International Committee for Democracy in Cuba, which is preparing for its inaugural meeting, as the history. In addition, there must be economic solidarity. For that purpose, I recently suggested the establishment of a Cuba fund for supporting families affected by repression, as well as other activities of the democratic opposition. I strongly believe that the European Union will come to a general agreement to steps to give practical support to Cuba's democrats. Has happened so far, and I think that we still need to work on it. I hope that there is no need to assure you that I will do whatever I can, in part to pay back the debt that I feel to those Democrats who helped me and my friends for many years, or who expressed their solidarity in various ways during their visits to communist Czechoslovakia. I will draw your attention to an observation of mine. Whatever your merits, however brave and respectable as dissidents you may be, even though you may have spent years in prison or written clever books, in spite of all of that, pragmatic politicians in the democratic world may suspect that you are mere grumblers, inveterate complainers, slightly crazy and constantly carping. Such a suspicion might lead to the following opinion. We may support them symbolically, but from the point of view of realistic politics, there is no need to rely on them. But they are not the right partners for us. And yet the opposite is true. It's important to convince politicians in democratic countries about this, which I have been trying to do for many years. Let me add a few more comments. Each Democrat who opposes a totalitarian regime should behave today as if power were to be handed over tomorrow. We were caught by surprise of how fast the exhausted communist system collapsed, and we were not prepared for an immediate takeover of power. We were thus forced to make all essential decisions under pressure of circumstances, a matter of days, sometimes even hours. But it was precisely the first moments in the transfer of power that were the most important. At that time, decisions were made that would affect the fate of the country for years to come. Whatever we didn't deal with at the beginning, we had to catch up on later with much greater difficulty. We ran up against the fact that we had not prepared a shadow cabinet and that we had not selected competent people who could be presented to the public as credible replacements for all the dysfunctional parliament. It turned out that for the most part we had not prepared the basic legislation for necessary democratic structures and for securing the country's economy during the coming months. Without clear laws, the quickest to come to the fore were the kind of people you mentioned in your letter, those for whom any system serves merely as a nail for their own ambitions, crooks capable of anything, and who have economic advantages based on the functioning of the functions they previously held. Last but not least, it's also worth considering who among the current politicians would make the best negotiating partners if the occasion for an handover of power should arise. And last paragraph. The proximity of the United States of America is surely perceived as a threat by many Cubans. The regime's propaganda is very active on this respect. Yet, there is no need to worry too much about such a world power, provided it remains democratic. One has to be apprehensive primarily about totalitarian states, whether near or far. Of course, a superpower like the United States exerts the sort of national gravitation that will always greatly influence small and neighboring countries. I believe that I can understand these worries, being from a small Central European nation myself. The main thing, however, is for Cubans to be able to decide for themselves about their future, with whom and under what conditions they do or don't want to cooperate. This must be an unmanipulated decision made by Cubans alone. No country has the right to impose anything on you or restrict your choices. Dear friend, I think that in spite of all the difficulties, it is worth treating this path. I firmly believe that despite the communist state's propaganda, a majority of Cubans realize that the countries of Central Europe started off in the right direction 14 years ago, and that it would be good to follow their example. Yours sincerely, Václav Havel. So, Rosa, I said everything what I could. Now, the time is yours. for his old friend, three things. This, like I said, you and Payá family in Cuba, and then what we are doing now.
Okay. These are very tough questions. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for taking the time of being here. I would like to start by, well, thank you for organizing this, and of course to the Václav Havel Library and Michael that should be here or be in a few minutes. And I start to think that it would be better if we just read all the letters of my father and Václav, because they have already said everything that we are actually doing right now, or we are thinking of fighting for in Cuba, and I think that also in the region, and of course that it has a global implication in our globalized world right now. But if I have to emphasize two or three topics that Václav Havel and my father used to write in their letters, I will start by the solidarity, the international solidarity and the solidarity between the folks that already lived and overcame to the darkened regimes and Cuban people and Cuban citizens. Because two things happened that was that were important in the sense of the subjective part of the fight, and is that when you are fighting for your rights, or when you are not fighting but living under the Tartarian regime that used to be also an isolated regime, you tend to think that you are alone, that nobody cares about it, that nobody knows about it, and if you have to explain it, it's going to be too complicated, and finally nobody's going to believe you. And we Cubans have the circumstance of, well, being an island, live in an island, but also to suffer all the marketing of the Cuban government about things that are not so related with the German regime, but with the international situation. And the confrontation, or the fake confrontation with the United States government, or the fact that we were or we are the last country, real communist country, that would be the hope of the rest of the communists in the world, or the rest of the good people, the people that wants freedom and liberties, and is of course against imperialism. All this rhetoric affects us in the way that you could agree more or less with all those ideas, but all those ideas doesn't justify the fact of the violation of the human rights of the Cuban people, but could masquerade that fact a lot. And if we see our situation, our regional situation, our closest neighbors, which are of course Latin American and United States, and I'm talking also about the academy in United States, a lot of unfair situations and unfair rhetoric has been built around the Cuban situation. Of course, that the marketing of the Cuban government, the way that they sell the educational system or the health system, or sometimes even the freedom that Cubans could enjoy, well, all these create a world that for Václav Havel was too easy to understand. Too easy to understand our situation, and that I think that this understanding was the key thing in the acceleration of the friendship between Václav Havel and my father. When my father got to Cuba a month after receiving the Sakharov Prize in Estrasbourg. He was already the friend of Václav Havel, and he talked about him and about people in Prague and about Bishop Mali as their partners. In some point, they get to that degree of understanding which, even when the situations are very similar and not the same, in some point we experiment the same thing, or at least the same feelings. And that suggestive situation leads to very practic things, to very realistic circumstances. The first one is, if you feel alone, you tend to do less, because you see no one is going to support you. And the second one is, the rest of the world, in some point, even the rest of the world that know the reality, I'm talking about high politicians, and I'm talking about the people that is actually, that knows more than just the regime propaganda, that people is also ready to talk with the Cuban government as if they were the exclusive interlocutors, as if they were, as they are, at the end of the day, the persons in charge, at the end of the day, they are the guys with the power, the powerful, and we are the powerless. Well, they are ready to buy or to believe, in a way, the marketing of the Cuban government and to deal with them. And some of them, the magnanimous, I'm ready also to take a picture with dissidents to say that they are in favor of human rights, but not actually to address dissidents or address civil society, independent civil society, as their interlocutors, as their equals. And that situation that Havel already narrated in their letters to my father is very related with what is going on right now. What is going on right now in Cuba with the engagement between the government of Havana, with the government, with the American government, and even with the conversations between EU and the Cuban government. Civil society, but more important civil society, citizenry, is excluded to that conversation, and it's in some way that's logic, because governments tend to talk with other governments. What is not logic here is that the Cuban government is not legitimate, and it's not legitimate because it has been never elected by the Cuban people. It's not legitimate because violate in a daily basis the more basic human rights. It's not legitimate because they kill persons, because they menace persons, they hit persons, they imprison persons because the way of thinking of that person, or because the free expression of that person. But in a context in which the democracies of the world, the powerfuls of the world, are talking with the Cuban government, or exclusively with the Cuban government, or at least they are taking the decisions just counting with the Cuban government, then it seems like this government that is not legitimate, that is led by a general that got to the power in a dynastic way, appear like more legitimate in front of the eyes of the international community. And people who want a free Cuba, good persons around the world that want to see democracy in the island, tend to think that there is a process of opening in the island, when in reality what has changed is just the foreign policy of foreign governments, but not the policies of the totalitarian regime in front of their own citizenry. Václav also talked to my father about one thing that I want to share, because was something that my father was working on in the same time that Václav Havel was writing to him, and was about the preparation for the day after, the preparation for the transition process, which is, it is not going to happen in a day, that is going to cover a period, and in a very unfair way, because you are fighting for your rights, you are being persecuted because you have no time for preparation, because you're fighting, you have to be prepared to the day after. And in 2004, that was the year of that letter, and my father and a group of persons, actually the majority of the opposition and a big part or a representative part of the dissidents in Cuba, were working in something called a national dialogue. That national dialogue, in reality, was a massive consultation where people in their houses had meetings that they called citizenry committees, and in these committees they discussed questions about the system, about which system they would like to have, and what things they would like to change in the current system. And there were questions about what is going to happen with the police, what is going to happen with the schools, what is going to happen with the house, with the previous owners, with the actual owners, what is going to happen with the economy? What is the political system that we would like to have? What things we would like to remain from this situation, and what things we have to change. And that was a dialogue in which around 15,000 of Cubans participate, which is in a country that has like 11 million of persons inside the island and 2.5 more millions outside. It's not a lot of persons, but it's a representative. Is a representative amount of citizens taking into account the conditions of repression, and taking into account also that was not a survey, was a process in which people have discussions together and get to conclusions together, and the result of this national dialogue is the transition program that a group of Cubans, my father, one of them, analyzing and compiling all these opinions. Well, they create this transition program not because they think that they had all the truth or that 15,000 people had all the truth, but because they knew, and Havel knew also, that they need to be prepared. They need to be at least a paper to discuss, at least some basis to start the discussion process over the base of, one, the opinion of the Cuban people, the size of the Cuban people, and two, actual tools, real tools that help them or the ones that lead the transition process, that not necessarily are the same ones that work in the transition program. Actually, my father was killed 3 years ago. But something that could help the people during the transition process to have, like, how you say, hoja de ruta?
Like a schedule, no? The pipeline.
Timetable.
Yeah. Like leads to follow during that process, and of course also the creation of the political alternative, of the creation of the consultation that could be, because you also need men and women to take part of the process, and it needs preparation and it needs to focus on what you want and not so in what is your political color, but what if you want to make this process through democracy a reality, and you need all the fractions of the society, all the fractions of the opposition to have this same goal. And that's what we call the creation of the political alternative, and that's also the work that we are doing right now. There are a lot of other things and observations that Havel did to my father that I think helped him to understand not so the reality in Cuba, but the global reality, the reality outside the island, the necessity of the solidarity and the way to talk to these potential partners, to these potential allies, in the way that they understand that, of course, that it's important to talk with government, but it's also important to talk with dissidents. It's also important to talk with the people that is promoting change in societies, because change are going to get now or in 3 years now, or in 5 years now, or in 10 years. And we could also, we as Cubans, but transition process could also lead to failures, could also lead to situations that don't help anybody, and especially in this context in which so many actors seem to be so concerned and so interested in the Cuban situation, as concerned and as interesting that there is like a competence in order to get to Cuba, to have a position in Cuba, to be there, because things are going to change. We just saw a sign in Berlin that reads "Vamos a Cuba," and we said, "Yeah, vamos a Cuba," which meant let's go to Cuba. And we have the sensation, the feeling that it's like, let's go to Cuba, let's go to see the zoo before the zoo disappeared, let's go to see these strange animals before savage capitalism destroyed everything. The thing is that the actual or the current generals in power in Cuba that have been in power for 56 years, they don't care so much about savage communists or savage capitalists. They are ready to go from the communists to a corporative, militaristic state. They are ready to pretend all that they have to pretend in order to make the international solidarity believe, or at least make easier for them to pretend that Cuba is changing. Because what they actually want is not an ideology. What they actually want is just to keep all the power and all the resources and make this transition from power to power, from them to their sons, or from them to them again, because I still don't believe that they think that they're going to die, but that's a possibility. But the only thing that we are not appealing to is the goodwill of the dictators. And it's so naive. I know they are not naive. I know that international community investors, the ones that say that Cuba is going to be a paradise for inversion, I know that they are not naive. But what is naive is to think that by making deals with the mafia, you could get good profits. By making the or to sell the idea that making deals with the mafia is going to, in some way, influence the mafia in a way that they're going to change their hearts and became suddenly democratic or factors of change for the Cuban society. And in this direction, I would like to address some points that are more related with what is taking place in the island. And I'm seeing two situations. The first one is the Cuban government has started many years before, so, well, 6-8 years before, this process of reforms that are sold to the international community as changes through the way of the democratization, but that actually, even when that reforms are made over very specific points and important points that are very significant to the Cuban people, as the migratory reform or the economic reform, or you could not believe it, but the concession to have cell phones, or the concession to enter to the hotels or enter to some touristic places in your own country, that have been reforms that this government has made. These changes are not made in the direction of recognizing that right. Are not made in the direction of recognizing, for instance, your right to travel in and out the island. But they are making in the sense of giving you the permit to travel. And the fact is, there is more people that is right now traveling. Why? Because there is more people that have that permit. But the power of decision remain in the hands of this bunch of generals. The power of decision remain in the hands of the government. And it means that people doesn't have the right to travel. They have the concession to do it. So in some way, they are privileged, or they are people with a permit that could lose that permit in any moment, because it doesn't depend on them, depend on the will of the Cuban government. So what they are actually creating with their reforms is hostages. What they are actually creating with their reform is even more vulnerable people. They are, that reforms are set as new control mechanisms. For instance, in order to have a very small business in Cuba, very small business thing means to sell peanuts in the street, or to cut the hair, or to open a window in your house and sell some breads and candies, that kind of things, because that's the kind of micro enterprises that Cubans could have. Don't think about real inversions or about getting rich. That's not the situation. But to have this a small business that doesn't allow to make you rich but allows you to survive, you don't need just to pay taxes. You also, in a tacit way, you made a pact with the government in which if you behave, you are going to remain your permit. If you suddenly start to see that you, besides selling peanuts, wants to read some kind of news or want to express some kind of opinions, then you probably are going to lose your license to sell peanuts. Or you're probably going to be repressed directly by the Cuban government. So you don't have to write the right to have an enterprise. You have a concession of the government and a permission, a privilege that allows you to survive, so you are an even more vulnerable. So that idea that economical changes, even when we don't have economical changes or substantial economical changes in Cuba, but that idea that economical changes leads to political changes, it could be true if the economical changes are recognition of your economical rights. But what is naive is to think that Cuban government doesn't study the transition process, doesn't study what happened in Eastern Europe, or what is going on in China, or what is going on in Uzbekistan, or what is going on in Russia. They already learned how the world could change and how could you change everything for not to change the real situation in this Lampedusa style, in this Gatto Pardo style, in which you could change everything to remain the same. And that's what they are doing, and that's what they are selling as the changes in Cuba. And with that, I would like to say that the only thing that the totalitarian regime doesn't play with is sharing the capacity of decision, sharing the power to take the decisions. That's why they never do real elections. That's why they never do multi-party elections. That's why they never go for the consent of the population. And that's why we are asking for that consultation. That's why our goal to get to the scenario in which we could apply Havel advices, in which we could apply a transition process, a transition program, or give the transition program to be destroyed and to create another one, and to build the country that we as human beings and as Cubans could create, we are trying to put very specific points that ask for allowing the people to participate, to promoting the citizenry participation. And that's what we are promoting with Cuba Decide, which is Cuba Decides, is the name of a campaign that is actually just promoting the right to decide of the Cuban citizenry, the right to decide of the Cuban population through a plebiscite. A plebiscite about the system, a plebiscite about the will of the people to remain or not the system that they have. And it being very concrete, asking to the people if they want to participate in free and multi-party elections. They have been more than 65 years in my country without real free and multi-party elections. This is a topic of national interest. So as it is a national interest, we as citizens, not just as opposition or civil society, as citizens, we have the right to ask for a consultation about it. And that's what is what we are promoting. Why? Why to consult the people about a right that should be granted, not consulted? We shouldn't care about if the humans, beings that live in Cuba, once or not rights. They have to have rights. They could do with their rights whatever they want, but they have it. The reality is that the Cuban government changed the constitution and closed the law in a way that it seems that the Cuban people is saying that they don't want that rights. In the constitution, we have the constitution of a unique party that says that the Communist Party is the director of the society, is the rector of the society, and also says that the economical, social, and political system cannot be changed. Never, by anyone. Not by the Castros, not by the National Assembly, not by the people. So, in front of this twisted document, the only thing that is over a constitution in a country is the will of the citizenry, is the sovereignty of the citizens. And that's why we are appealing to that sovereignty. That's why we are appealing, and we are trying to build this big campaign in order to have a plebiscite in Cuba, just as Chileans have their plebiscite. And of course, that is not just the fact plebiscite, it's the fact campaign. It's the international solidarity that we need. Is the conditions that we need to have a credible plebiscite in Cuba, because they already learned how to win elections in Latin America, in Venezuela, and in the rest of these countries that have been so interfered by the Cuban government. But in order to have a clean plebiscite, We need international presence in the island. We need access to the media. We need internet access. We need a period of exercise of some rights which are important for before that plebiscite to take place. And that's what we are trying to put right now over that table of negotiations that have excluded civil society, that have excluded citizenry, but that could include some points that actually help us. Because they have to have an agreement on human rights, but that agreement on human rights cannot be symbolic, cannot be what Havel told to my father about you are not the real interlocutors, about just talking with the power. Have to be concrete things that leads to an effective solidarity, but that leads at least to the point in which we could measure if the Cuban government is actually making changes or is just making another masquerade. And I think that with that, I could end, and maybe you have some suggestions, ideas, criticisms, or questions.
So we have economic diplomacy, this question, Rosa.
will start with Catholic Church. Catholic Church was never completely disappeared in Cuba, even when it was very persecuted, and it was at all other alternative expressions were persecuted, not just religion, even when a serious process of de-Christianization was implemented by the Cuban government, were not just religious people the ones that were persecuted. People were persecuted because they listened to the Beatles, because they were men with long hair, because they talk English, because they have family in the United States. All these circumstances were expressions because of their sexual orientation, because of all alternative expressions and sometimes alternative circumstances were persecuted in Cuba. People was stolen from the country or sent to concentration camps. My father was one of them. He's 17 years old. He spent 3 years in a concentration camp in forced labors with priests, with people that loved rock and roll, with people that had a family or that were trying to escape from the island. This very close situation took place in Cuba during the 60s and 70s. In the late 80s and in the 90s, there was some kind of relaxation of that policies, in which, of course, the visit of John Paul II was an important part. But reality is that actual persecution against alternative expressions and specifically against Catholic Church, because we tend to think, and in some places it is like that Catholic Church could be also a power, or is for sure an institution that is independent to the communist line of the government. This is always dangerous for totalitarian. So persecution has not actually ended, but has became more subtle. And softer in a way, but subtle. I mean, the state security is still going to mass, is still menacing priests, is still menacing monks, is still in a tacit confrontation with the arguments of the party, but you can go to mass and nothing is going to happen to you. You can sometimes even go to public manifestations of that. And the situation in Cuba is that as the whole population, as all the citizens that belong to the hierarchy of the Catholic Church are also subject to the same repression and the same conditions of the Cuban government. And we happen to have a church which is very committed with the people, which have suffered the same sin of the people, which has helped the people and also the civil society, and thinking about the ladies in white, the wife of the prisoners of the 75 that were protected by religious communities that sometimes have to travel a lot and spend the night in the house of the monks in order to go to see their husband in prison. Even when we have that reality of a very commitment grassroots church, we have also a reality of a hierarchy, and especially a cardinal, which, in my opinion, is too conditioned by the Cuban government. So sometimes the public image that is, of course, in charge of the hierarchy of the church is not exactly the more committed with the people necessities, and sometimes it's too conditioned to for me to close to the line of of the Cuban government. That's my opinion. In order to to rectify economic policy, I don't think that isolation is a way to actually provoke democracy or to help democracy. And what I know for sure is that in the case of the embargo to Cuba was never sought as a way to democratize the island. Was sought as a tool to deal with the ones that came after that come after this totalitarian regime. Was sought as a tool to have some pieces to negotiate with the one for that were about to come, right? After the Castro's, after the totalitarian regime, and not as a way to democratize the island. So in that sense, and in the sense also that are very good tools in the hand of this totalitarian regime to solve their position of victims, the confrontation with the imperialists, even when in the case of Cuba, at least in the case of Cuba, the Cuban government has never stopped conversations with the American government. Have been leveled on different levels of conversation with the American government almost the whole period, the 56 years they have been talking in some level with the American administrations. The fact is, when you have a totalitarian regime that doesn't allow the Cuban or the society to have access to the democratic resources that are needed in order to have some level of understanding with investors, with foreign investment, with any kind of or without any kind of juridic personality, you are in a way you have the option to negotiate with the government and to make business with the government. And in that way, to give credit to the American, to the Cuban government in American banks is to give credit to the totalitarian regime in the American banks. That's a reality. Now, is that going to democratize Cuba? No. Is that the problem of the Cuban people? No. The embargo is not the problem of the Cuban people. To lift the embargo is going to solve the problem of the Cuban people? No, because it's not a problem in the first place. So instead of put the debate about if the sanctions should be applied or not, I will put the debate in the coherency of the whole policy with these totalitarian regimes. Because at the end of the day, the sanctions, or to keep the speech and to keep the point on the sanctions, is better to these totalitarian regimes, because you are not discussing the real problem. You are not discussing the right to decide of the Cuban people. You are discussing a law that cannot be affected by the Cuban citizenry, that affect or not, depending on the reality of the law, the society, but it's not the real root of the problem. The real root is a totalitarian regime that has embargoed the human rights of the Cuban people or of the Iranian people. And that's the topic that should be raised in conversation. In that type of conversations, maybe the conversations about business, about an economical trade, should be penetrated with, and that's a word that you used to use, should be penetrated by the human rights dialogue, but not in the style of the symbolic solidarity, not in the style of course we support towards civil society and will take pictures with each dissident that gets to Brussels. Or maybe we'll travel to Havana to take more realistic pictures. No, in the sense that they put over the table of negotiation the plebiscite in Cuba. They put on the table of negotiation the ending, to end with the impunity of the Cuban government, and that's the point that I didn't get to touch, but the fact is that with negotiations and without negotiations, the repression against civil society is huge. The repression against alternative expressions is huge. And I'm talking, of course, about the killing of my father and Harold, but I'm also talking about the beatings to the ladies in white and all the activists that manifest publicly in the street about the political prisoners, about all the realities that are remade while powerful guys are talking and stop in that conversations when to keep talking became more important than what are you talking about.
Buenas noches, bienvenida, gracias.
Hola.
Raúl Sorosa, I'm from Ecuador, I'm a journalist, I have a question. You spoke about the day after, or the plans after, and we were speaking also about the property. What are your thoughts about the day after and the restitution in Cuba? Many industries and houses and land belongs to Americans. What will happen the day after? What kind of plan? The Czechs have some experience about restitution, but they have also some limits. What they can put back to the private hands. Have you some thoughts in what will happen the day after with the restitution?
Yes, of course.
Can I?
Okay, so please, Orlando.
Just to add the second question, if you can, Orlando Vipardo, if you can comment on the actual migratory crises that are taking place in Cuba, and in a way I have think about this as a plebiscite, but not with real votes, but with the decision of a people to vote with their feet. Sometimes I call that the pedestrian plebiscite. We vote in favor of the revolution, in favor of Fidel Castro, while next day we are waiting for the visa lottery to migrate to the United States, or we just become rafters or part of the human trafficking through Latin America, because we know that voting for Fidel or for Raúl Castro is an easier way to escape the country and return to the country without trouble. So if you can comment about the blackmail or how this connects with rights or with privilege, the migratory
situation. Let's have the third one and then you answer to all of them, please.
Paolo, good evening. I have a very simple question. You know, Martin mentioned before we started, you know, that he had a meeting with Mr. Amache and his support and support of Czech people. Could you refer very briefly what kind of support it is?
What kind of support?
It is Mr. Amache. Answer what you want, and maybe I'll add some few words to the Czech situation. But start with you.
Okay, about restitution, I give you my opinion in a minute, but I could tell you what has been written about and what actually is part of one of the initiative of law that not just my father, but several people in the restitution start to promote. And in the sense of for instance, the House of the People, the consent that was also in some way that appeared also in that national dialogue was that properties that were in the hands of families, even when that families didn't have the title, because it doesn't belong to them, it belonged to others that were confiscated by the Cuban government, or that travel out, or that escape, or which are in exile, or which are foreign, persons, that houses and that properties should remain in the hands of the families that are living there. The other ones, the ones that belong to the Communist Party or which are being used by the Communist Party, could be used as a tool for restitution, as a tool for some kind of transitional justice. That was one of the points of the initiative of law called Valera Project, which was is also known as the project of reunification of the Cuban citizenry, because what was talking also about the right to travel in and out, about the right to reunite the families, also about a right that we in Cuba we don't have, and it's to free move within the island. You could be called and declared illegal in your own country if you are from the Inter Park and you are in Havana, even as a tourist, you could be declared illegal and be deported to your native province in the islands. And that actually, this initiative of law that was presented around 8 years ago had the same points that the Cuban government has changed, but in the sense that the Cuba, for instance, the migratory reform has several points that were also in the Valera project, but the Valera project have it or has it as recognition of the rights, and the Cuban government did it as permits in order to keep the control over society, in order to keep the power of decision. So I think that transitional justice is important. I think that also to move forward and to build the country that we could build and remain the safety of everybody in the island is also important. So we will have to get to a commitment between what has to be done and what should be done.
One sentence to that, then we have Orlando's question concerning migration and then Czech attitude. I think that one needs to be very clear and make distinction between international perception, the claims made from the United States and to be used before the US courts, for instance, and then the communication between Cuban government and Cuban people. And I think that both dimensions are here, cannot be separated one from another, and obviously Cuban people is the most important player in this game. In our Czechoslovak case, for instance, we had our restitution laws, but also what was taken into consideration was a deal that was already my compensation. Czechoslovak communist government had to negotiate about the US government for the nationalization of certain properties. They were some deals made, so there are two things here, but it's a quite complex and important discussion. And the danger is that this should not be easily ideologized, turned into simplistic white black schemes, because reality is always much more complicated. Now, Orlando's question.
Yeah, the Orlando's statement was about the what is going on right now in the border between Costa Rica and Nicaragua. There are more than 3,000 Cubans, which are, in my opinion, are political refugees that are trying to get to the United States. They are trying to get to the United States because they are escaping from the misery that they are living in Cuba. I think also because they have no opportunities, or they found no opportunities to change their reality because they have no human rights, because they have I think that everybody understood that this is a political problem with economic, with social, with cultural implications after 56 years and counting. And these persons are right now in the border. They were trying to get to the United States because if they get to the United States, they could legally remain in the United States because they are considered asilados.
There is a special law, Cuban Adjustment Act, that allows Cubans to legalize within a year their stay on the territory of the United States, despite the fact that they enter the territory without already legal documents to do so. So that's the situation out on the border.
That's the situation on the border, and the Cuban government, I think that that situation is in a way provoked and promoted by the Cuban government. There's not a way in which thousands of Cubans could get to Costa Rica without any facilitation from the part of the Cuban government. So they are trying to push the things with probably with the American government. They are trying to force the limit of this Cuban Adjustment Act. But also what Orlando was raising was the point that Cuban people have already decided. What we want is to make this decision by them. What we want is with this initiative that is trying to promote the making of this plebiscite. We want that voice could be obeyed by the authorities. But the fact is that this lie that the Cuban government fostered in the whole world about how happy the Cubans are in the island is easily destroyed by this pedestrian plebiscite in which everybody in Cuba, or the most part, or a very important part of the Cuban, just want to escape.
Well, just to add to that, you even have a quite cynical interpretation of the fact that only this year the number of refugees from the island increased 70%, I think 44,000 people. And it can be said that because now there are more opportunities for Cubans living outside of Cuba to send their money to support their relatives, but a significant part of this money ends up in the pockets of government and governmental coffers. And this is actually one of the most significant the contribution to the Cuban state budget. So that maybe these people are there for a certain purpose, because the more people you have out, the more money you will get from them they make in the United States. But obviously this decision is totally crazy, because it has devastating demographical effects, and from long-term perspective, because only young and capable people are escaping, and then you will have an island with the average age going up and no economic performance whatsoever. But now let's go to the Czech question. I would just make it more general. We've met with Mr. Hamáček today, so your impressions, and then what do you think about Czech contributions to the Cuban debate in general?
I think, well, I have experienced Czech solidarity. My family, and I think that the whole democratic movement have experienced Czech solidarity, and not just with this link between Václav Havel and my father, but with people in need, with Václav Havel Library, with a lot of friends and organizations that I actually care about changing or help to change the things in Cuba. I think that in some periods, Czechs have been almost our unique friends abroad. I also think that there is more concrete and specific things that could be done. And that's why we had this this meeting, and that's why we are trying to propose to the Czech parliamentarians, to the Czech government, to the Czech foreign minister, to promote these concrete things to be raised in the table of negotiation with the Cuban government, between the European Union and the Cuban government, because there's no recognition for civil society, and that's a very bad thing, but there is no recognition to Cuban citizenry, and that's worse. That's why we're trying that. The plebiscite was a part in that agreement, the at least the invitation to the Cuban government to celebrate this plebiscite or to allow this plebiscite what have to be in that table of negotiations, but also the concrete measurements that can be taken in order to restrict the impunity of the Cuban government. Also, the liberation of the political prisoners. Also, the stopping the repression in the streets. Also, for instance, an investigation on the attack of my father and Carlos Epero, because the thing with impunity is the consequence. If the Cuban government can keep doing things and is not having any consequence for the bad things, for the repression that he is applying inside the island, then impunity continues. And that impunity is toxic and is we are also seeing impunity in Venezuela and seeing impunity in Nicaragua and seeing impunity in other parts of our region, which has been very interfered by the Cuban government. And we have this situation in which you could agree more or less with the current government in Latin America, but the fact is that they make silence over the critical cases. They make silence about Cuba, they make silence about the child that were murdered in the streets of Caracas a year ago. They made silence about the repression of Ortega over the rise of the laborers and especially los mineros. I don't know how to say that in English.
Miners,
thank you. So to break this wall of silence could be the most important contribution of the
check
to our current situation.
Okay, if I can just complete that perspective and then we will go to the end, because still there are some refreshments prepared for us and then we might be able to continue in a friendly and informal conversation. What I'd like to add is that obviously Czech contribution is significant. We have our ups and downs with Václav Havel being president. It was more articulate, easier, but still the thread of this tradition has not been entirely broken. And I think that we have been able to achieve certain goals. It takes time, it takes patience, a little bit of diplomacy to communicate with the Foreign Office in Prague, of Ministry for Foreign Affairs. But it seems to me that in this moment, some people might be inclined to believe that things are very bad. It's not true. I think that we have still all lines of communication open. We need to come up with some sort of creative solutions and exactly to try always to try to turn or transform all these symbolic gestures that are now into practicalities and practical actions. There is a negotiation going on between the European Union and Cuban government, started in early last year. There is a process between government of the United States and Cuba also. And we have tried, and I think that we made quite spectacular successes, like this conference in Berlin with participation of members of Bundestag, clearly articulating the view very close to Rosa's. We had actually very serious discussion, and it's always, I think, a little bit a challenge for those sociologists who like to observe and comment from their sometimes very deep prejudicial positions, the situation, to listen to real Cubans. Because I think real Cubans are those who should be the first to speak competently about Cuban realities. And the very end, we have ourselves quite interesting and good experience with what was Helsinki process. 40 years in summer of this year, the final act of this conference was signed. If you don't remember, look at that. There were three baskets there: peace and security, economic cooperation, and human rights. And it was a declaratory statement, not a legally binding document. And then, because the third basket helped independent initiatives here to step in and to claim their rights to participate, things that on the beginning looked like a helpless game, governments to governments, just exchanging platitudes in their friendly conversation, produced some results. And I think we have a good reasons to believe that this will not take us another 15 years. It was the case of the Helsinki process. This will go very fast. But it's a time to act, and I think that Rosa is a great person to take the lead on the Cuban side. Thank you very much.